Thanks all of you for coming. This is a really wonderful book, Boat Rocker, and it's a great pleasure to have you here, Ha Jin. And so let me start off. Emily alluded to the fact that the painter, Zhao Wuqi, lived in these two worlds, as you do. And I wonder, you were last in China in 1985.
Yes.
So how do you kind of arrange that in your mind, that you were Chinese, you grew up in Chinese, you have deep sort of feelings, commitments, and yet here you are in America? How do you put these two pieces together?
But I came, I didn't expect to stay for long. I was a graduate student at Brandeis University. Mm-hmm. So my plan was to finish my PhD in 4 years, then return to China, to Shandong University. I had a job waiting for me there as a researcher in American literature. So it was a good job. But then in 1989, the Tiananmen massacre or event happened. So that was a turning point. I couldn't go back. But gradually, I didn't mentally, I was not prepared to immigrate. But my son arrived. 2 months later, my son arrived. So at that point, I realized that he would become American. But I wasn't sure of myself. But then, step by step, I couldn't find a job in anything related to Chinese because all my degrees were in English. That's why. So I got deeper into the English studies. I became a professor in English. And in fact, a year after the Tiananmen massacre, I began to write devotedly in English. Before that, I had been writing both in Chinese and in English, but I thought eventually I would be a writer in Chinese because I plan to return to China. So the feeling of this is, in a way, of course, there was a lot of frustration, a lot of pain too. On the other hand, I'm also fortunate, at least I had the choices, and there has always been room for me to figure out how to move next step for personal development in that sense. So I think it's a bittersweet experience.
Do you ever feel homesick?
I'm in a different situation. I think the longing nostalgia is always there, but I had to be rational about this because I can't see where my hometown is. My father was an officer, so his units, they move around a lot. So I live in different towns in northeast of China. So I couldn't say where my hometown is. And as a result, I don't have the sense of the deep, my country. The country in that sense is, you know, in the word, in fact, originally refers to your village, your piece of land, your father's land. I do not have that. I do not have that sense, that kind of attachment. But I do have a kind of illusion. Going somewhere in China, living in a coastal town, very peaceful. I don't have to get up early in the morning, go to work. But that was just fantasy, so I had to suppress that. So the pain and the longing are there, we have to accept the world as it is.
Can you talk a little bit about your decision to write in English? And do you feel that you have a different personality writing in English? Do you think that it's shaped your work, the fact that you're writing in English and not Chinese?
Yes, I think the English, as a language, I think English is more open. See, the Chinese language, especially literary language, is is separated from natural speech. We have all kind of dialects. For instance, in Shanghainese and Cantonese are like foreign languages to me. But when we come to the page, basically we use the same written word. And without the literary word in Chinese is quite rigorous. It's a different kind of discourse, somewhat separated from the natural speech. So that might partially explain why a lot of Chinese, especially Chinese women, when they learn English, they begin to write English, they feel the experience kind of a liberating experience. Suddenly they feel they can write so many things. But in Chinese, and especially if you want to write literally, it's very hard. You have to learn the language, really master the language.
Do you think that's changing, though, as people are writing novels on the internet? There's all these internet
yes.
novels happening, and it's kind of a different kind of Chinese, I would think.
Sure, I think so, yes. That's why we have so many idioms, so many expressions, a lot of new terms. But still, we have people who speak, for instance, a writer in the south, southern China, is always somehow at a disadvantage compared with writers mm-hmm. in the north, because the dialects are far away from the written word. And imagine a person from Sichuan, then you don't write, if you don't speak Mandarin, the standard language well, it's not easy, it's not that easy, mm-hmm. it's different. But English has a lot of space. We have all kinds of Englishes, right? As long as you make it clear, every kind of English is acceptable. It's possible to become a literary language. So there is a difference there. But for me, it's more than that. It's so a means of survival. Also, in the language, there has been a great tradition in which non-native speaking authors, writers became essential writer, mainstream, right? Mm. Joseph Conrad and Nabokov. There is a tradition there. So, in other words, there are references. So there is a way there. It's not. It's already open. So I think that's the beauty of the language. But there are a few Westerners, I think, who in China who have started writing in Chinese. I think that was a few of them. I think one called Mo Li. I think they write well. I think, in other words, this tradition eventually might appear in Chinese too.
Mm-hmm. I mean, part of it is, if the Chinese language has a certain confinement, of
yes.
course, it's also within a certain kind of a traditional
yes.
culture.
Sure.
That has always been somewhat more confined, and then it's
yeah.
within a
yeah.
political system that is,
yes.
Once again, has its confinement.
Yes, I think it's conventional. That's true. There is a term called the 正名, ratification of names. Mm. The form of the words, the usage of the words must be very, very exact. I think there was an anecdote, a recorded historical anecdote, a courtier wrote a petition to the emperor, and he left a dot in the character, a horse, four dots, but he left a dot. He left out a dot, and he was terrified. He thought he would be either thrown into jail or executed. So that was a crime if you distort the form of the words. In fact, in the early 90s, when printer, the computer and the printers were becoming popular. There was a rule, very brief, for a short period of time, there was a rule announced by the Chinese government. You cannot use printer, the fonts. You cannot use the fonts randomly. That must be fixed. Still, that echoed the tradition. But now, of course, the technology is anywhere, everywhere. That's why the language is getting looser or open. But there has been a tradition. It's not just cultural confinement, also political mm-hmm. confinement.
You write in the Boat Rocker about a writer, I suppose, in certain ways, from your own experience, who is here and is imagining himself as writing with enormous freedom, even about things relating to China. And then, of course, China enters the American market, buys his company, gets him fired, and he finds that the tentacle has sort of reached out. It seemed to me that that was sort of written ahead of its time. I mean, because this is about China when you were writing this novel 5-6 years ago. But just talk about how you view that that effort now by China to reach out and have soft power influence around the world by companies to expand its system.
In fact, the novel just set in 2005. But I started to write it in 2 years after that, in 2007. But it was a hard book for me. That's why over the years I've been working on it, and as time developed, so a lot of details were shaded towards to become more resonant to our current situation. But again, the Chinese. Even the states, the Chinese state and the government, they have been buying stuff long ago, but it was not that obvious. I think many years ago, 10 years ago, I would say, already started acquiring facilities, factories too.
But now they're doing Hollywood studios. Who knows, media outlets as you.
Yes, a lot. And I think the Chinese government acquired a lot of media facilities near in Asia, but now it's obviously it becomes more aggressive.
I think your book also touches on a really interesting and really important trend, which is that, you know, not so long ago, if you were writing about China in America as a novelist or a journalist, you had the sense that there were these two separate worlds. You know, China's here, we're there, you know, I can say what I want, it doesn't really matter. Yeah. And I think your book really shines a light on how that's really not so true anymore at all. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's, you know, if you write about China and you think about China and you care about China, and you're writing in English in America, it's not totally divorced, and I think your book really illustrates that.
You're right. I think you're absolutely right. You cannot do that because you have the freedom. Then you can do whatever you want. That's a kind of abuse of freedom. Mm-hmm. Also, if you want to write a literary work, then you have to think about how to deal with translatability. Mm-hmm. For me, that is one of the major principles. That means if the book is translated back into Chinese, it must be meaningful to the Chinese. And that is kind of standard, also a test of the integrity of the work. That's why I always have the Chinese readers in the back of my mind when I write. Whether I write in English or Chinese, and I think that has to be a part of the creative process.
But I mean, even if you're not thinking about the Chinese readers per se, you know, I've talked to authors in the past who told me really interesting stories that, you know, they'd be writing something about China that was seen as critical, and they would have a speaking event, for example, in the United States, and then the host of the event would get nervous because they have a partnership with China or because they get funding from China. So I feel like your book really illustrates something that I think is becoming more prevalent by the day.
Oh, sure, yes. It happened long ago. I think in 2003 or sometime around that period, I was, in fact, a big American magazine committed a piece that I'm supposed to write. I did finish the piece. They liked it, but at the final moment, because of China, they couldn't use it. And so that happened all the time, yes. China has
because of China,
everywhere.
Because they were being sold in China, or they were afraid of getting banned in China?
I think at the time the magazine wanted to get into Chinese market.
Yeah, you know? Everybody wants to get into the Chinese market.
So
everybody.
Even before that, I remember I was invited by New Zealand for a writer's festival, a literary festival. At the last moment, they said they told me China would not allow. This was, I think, in in the year 2000.
Yeah, I think that's one of the things that's so important about this book right now at this moment in time, because I think when people think about China and politics and dissent, they're like, oh, that's China's issue. Mm. But it's not really.
Everywhere.
Not really China's issue. It's also can really affect people in the United States as well.
Absolutely. I think you see the guy, in fact, He Ping, you know, he's a publisher, also he's a kind of expert in Chinese politics. He's living in New York City. And he had invented a term, Chinese virus. Basically, that means it's everywhere. You can. It's very hard to really be immune to that.
I'm just reading the book here. I mean, I've read it, but I was just skimming through it because there's so many parts that really made me sit up. And like a good schoolboy, I was underlining away. And I just wanted to read, I mean, one could read many different sections and just to see what was in your head when you wrote it and what you thought, why you wrote it. So here, let me just read this section here. Okay. The fact is that whoever holds state power speaks for the country. I simply don't buy that nonsense, that the country is a benign, magnanimous matriarch that spawned and raised all the citizens, who in turn must behave like filial children, bowing to her will. That's a lullaby, a fetish for dopes, or a tall tale that corrals people into servitude. I've outgrown all that. If a country misbehaves, people have every right to rein it in, give it a good kick in the ass, and fix it. This is the responsibility of the citizen. And then he says, he doesn't want to shut up. He says, the powers that be never use the word state when they brainwash people and condemn dissidents. They always kept themselves as identical as possible with the country so that they can appear legitimate and sacred. Anyone against the totalitarian government is classified and punished as a traitor of the country. It's time for us to look the country in the face and debunk its myth and sanctity.
Well, you know, this is a narrator. Yeah, this is a narrator. He's much younger than me. So, so you know, I want to create a young character, a young guy in his 30s, and a very outspoken, very straightforward. And so that's why he was troublesome to many Chinese. But on the other hand, I think he tells truth. That means in China, I think even among Chinese, we tend to think that the country is great, the parties are bad and selfish. But the truth is, the party in power always make itself identical with the country. The country is deified. We tend to forget that the country was created by people. The country is supposed to serve people. And the basis for democracy is the individual and the state should be equal. Read the Constitution, the U.S. Constitution. Basically, it's a contract between the people and the country. So that's why I think, if we look at this objectively, there should be no distinction between the state and the party. For instance, at UN, is the Communist Party that represents China. Nobody else can do that. So we see a lot of things, in fact, whoever in power speaks of the country is the country. So that's why I think not me, but the protagonist, the narrator, Fan Lin, he believes that the country is mystified, deified, should be reduced to a common apparatus. Like he used the word, a set of a machine. Each ministry is like a machine. In the workshop, so that is the country to him. I think that's for a lot of young people. That is, for instance, my son's friends, his generation. They don't view country as like a god figure. A country is something made, like a house, made by human beings, by citizens. That also means it should be like a shelter, big shelter, serve and protect people. So that's why he was so angry, because his good friend
could not tolerate him speaking against the country, make no distinction between the country and the party. But for him, I think he doesn't deliberately to mix the two together so as to reduce the country to the level of human level.
So, you know, one thing that always impresses me, and I think it's become even more obvious now, is that the Chinese have a very deep and abiding sense of patriotism.
Yes.
A kind of a yearning
yes.
to see their country strong mm-hmm. and respected. And yet your hero, your main character, has a very obviously complicated relationship
yes.
with the notion of patriotism.
Yes, yes.
And how do you feel about patriotism? and are you patriotic?
Not really, not mm-hmm. really. I think the Chinese are more patriotic perhaps because religions have been suppressed. So as a result, a lot of religious longings and yearnings were diverted to the country. The country is deified. And that's part of it. Let's assume if you are Buddhist, if you are a Christian, shouldn't your temple or your church be bigger than your country? That's common sense, right? If you're a good Buddhist, you are not supposed to kill or to hurt others. And then when your belief and your country's interest both are at odds, you have to decide if you're a good Buddhist, you would go to for your religion. You would not, so the country should be smaller than the temple or the church. So there are, in other words, there are many, many kind of values, systems that are much bigger than the country. For I'm trying to write literature. That means literature as a system is bigger than a state. For instance, when we talk about Cao Xueqin or Li Bai, we don't know the kings, the emperors of that time. It doesn't matter, because these works, they belong, they have their position in a different system that is really bigger and broader than the state. The same with the language, Chinese. You cannot say Chinese is a part of China. China is only part of Chinese, right? The Chinese is used everywhere. It belongs to the world, in fact. So I think that's why we had to get out of that. The vision and imagination shaped or confined by the state.
Emily, forgive me if I go one more round here.
Sorry.
Because you mentioned this Confucian idea that the name yeah. of something
yes.
has to actually describe the reality. Mm. It was yeah. the sort of a basic principle
yes.
in the Confucian analect.
Yes.
But that is true. But what you did not note was that this is sort of impossible in a system where the narrative or history or even mm-hmm. literature is being controlled according to some sort of party view.
Yes.
Because then you get tremendous distortion of language.
I know, yes. In fact, there's a lot of verbiage, you know, the garbage even created by, in contemporary Chinese, because of the propaganda and also political necessity that really create new distortions. And a lot of facts, in fact, facts we accepted were actually generated by words. The words are not accurate anymore. That is a violation of the traditional Chinese values, Confucius values. That is very hard. It's very damaging, in fact, very destructive to a culture and society. Because by Confucian, that ideology basically words and the facts must match. Otherwise, it will create chaos. People can't communicate and others will be distorted. So that will be eventually will lead a country to disaster.
And so on the language point, I've heard another side of that argument that
sure.
I'd be curious to hear your reaction to. Some writers who write in China will say, well, actually, because there's so many constraints on language and because there's so much censorship, writers actually have to be even more creative to say what they mean, right? They have to play with words. They have to say things indirectly. You know, there's all sorts of examples like that. You know, you can't say June 4th, so you say May 35th, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah. And there's been a lot of writing about that. And you know, some authors have made the case that, you know, actually there is, you know, again, if you go, the internet is sort of my area, so I keep referencing it. But if you, you know, if you look on the Chinese internet and you look at all the wordplay and the imagination, and I'm just curious what your thoughts are on that.
I think this is not only in China, but decades ago, it was like this in Eastern Europe, right? And that's why a lot of Chinese intellectuals and artists, they still try to look for models in Eastern European countries. But that was basically is a kind of creative phenomenon or energy generated by oppression or suppression. Mm-hmm. But on the whole, I think it is not a good thing, on the whole, to the artist. You cannot open yourself. You cannot speak like this guy, Dan Lin. You cannot say that. But I think the effort, the manifestation of the creativity, I think that's great, that's heroic. But the destructive destruction is there. And I do feel that it'd be better to have an open space and order.
In your opinion, because I know you speak honestly, is there any truly great literature coming from within China right now?
I think there has been a genuine literature, a lot of genuine literature, I would say. Great, I can't use that word, because great needs a test of time. Mm-hmm. And so, but I think my impression is most of the Chinese writers, they are, many of them are very talented, extremely talented, but somehow they have kind of the censorship within and without. That is, I think, that's why I think that is very destructive and damaging to the creative spirits. And for instance, if I write in Chinese, I know this will be published in mainland China. I had to censor myself. Mm-hmm. Intuitively, I know what could be printed. See, that was it, but in English, I do not have that. Mm-hmm. I do not have that. It's a matter of taste. You can't be vulgar, because then you reduce yourself, you abase yourself. You can't be that low, right? You don't want to do that. But it's not because of censorship. It's basically your own education, your own cultivation as a writer. So that's very different. But in Chinese, basically, you would think whether this will be cut or should you cut first. That kind of.
And that deforms.
I know, sure, work. Yes. And more outrageously, sometimes everything is fine, but even the publisher and the editor, they had to cut something in order to prove that they did some work.
But you know, what's interesting is that your book really is about the way in which the line, which was once much more absolute, and if you could get across the line out of that environment you've just described to a Western country, then you didn't have to worry about the consequences of censorship. But your book is really about how censorship actually follows.
Of course, you know, there are a lot of, in fact, I do have a friend who wrote essays regularly. He was completely censored. And
even in China or here?
Here.
And how was
but he wrote in Chinese. He writes in Chinese. He couldn't, so he has a major, his name, even name is not allowed to mention in mainland China media. So that is, but maybe now it's a little better, I don't know. But
I don't think it's better.
I don't know, that's why I'm not sure. But apparently the guy was really confined and in fact suppressed, isolated. Also a lot of China scholars too, you know, many of them cannot go and visit China because They were labeled as somebody, persona non grata, or something they did to China negatively. But all these are the labels. So I think it's not just Chinese writers or journalists, a lot of scholars are in the same situation.
Yeah, and you don't even need to be a writer or a scholar. You could be in Hollywood film producer making a film that's not even about China, that has one Chinese character in it or some, 5 minutes that have to do with China, and they will actually make those cuts in order to get into the Chinese market. So, it's happening industry-wide, which again is why I think your book is so important to talk about right now.
But on the other hand, I don't know, the business people, really, profit is a big deal. That's why sometimes they will sacrifice everything just for profit. That's true, the capitalist system. And I think the Chinese state has been taking advantage of that.
Since Orville read something from your book, I feel like I have to also just to show that I read your book.
Reading the quotations of Chairman
I can't have you, one up agree here. I just actually thought this is actually just two sentences. I'm not totally sure what you meant, so I'd be really interested for you to explain it a little bit. You have this line, people of Chinese background like me have little sense of identity. In fact, the word identity is alien to us, and I still don't know precisely how to translate it into Chinese. I just thought that was interesting. I'm just curious what that means.
We don't have the word identity. Like a word like a logic, in China, in Chinese, luoji, right? It's direct translation. We borrow the concept. And identity, in Chinese, shenfen, but not exactly.
That's almost status.
Status, similarity, many things. We don't have such a word. So that means, that indicates, in fact, I got confused when I was a graduate student, I came upon this word. It took years for me to really know it thoroughly. So that means that's why the guy here, he speculates on this. He thinks maybe we don't have the strong sense of selfhood. Mm-hmm. That could be true.
Well, what do you think?
I think culturally, individualism is a negative term. Was a negative term in Chinese.
Identity?
No, individualism.
But how would you describe what it means to be Chinese today? I mean, what are the identity elements, the values, the principles, the things that come to mind if you're trying to describe to someone what it means to be Chinese?
I think that's I think that varies from person to person, but some basic principles, I would think similarity is a huge, I would emphasize identity. In this sense means similar to others, similarity. Even in Confucianism, Ren, benevolence, humanity, it's a basic principle. And this is, in fact, this overlaps with many other religions. Also, I think, I do feel that kindness is very important, no matter what. Even the Chinese in Chinese culture, there is one lot of emphasis on this. We have idioms like di shui zhen, yi yong quan xiang bao, right? One job of goodwill, a good deed should be rewarded with a pool, a fountain of kindness, something like that. And all these, I think, really are important. And also, I think we tend to forget. In the Chinese culture, there is a huge emphasis on trust. That one, I think, is lost.
Personal trust.
Just among people, personal trust. Really, the word really means a lot. You give the promise, that means a lot. That's why we said a word is supposed to be as heavy as a mountain. We have that kind of idioms, right? And in fact, in Tang Dynasty, I can't say the exact year, but there was a story, in fact, a fact. The emperor allowed hundreds of prisoners to go home for spring for a festival, celebrate a festival, on the condition that they must come back. I think that more than 700. Every one of them returned.
Then the emperor was so moved, he basically released every set them free. And so that shows really trust was a huge, it's a big deal. I think that is really essential in the culture. Imagine a culture that continues and basically in the same cultural order for thousands of years. You have to have this basic, have this kind of basic value, but that is lost somehow. See, the Koreans, when they go to Russia, they will, no, Chinese goods, when the Koreans would sell for the Chinese because people don't trust Chinese anymore.
But, you know, when I first went to China in 1975, I used to have to go almost every day into a study meeting. Mm-hmm. And one of the things we had to study was the movement to Pi Lin Pi Kong, to criticize Lin Biao and criticize Confucius.
Yes.
So do you think that the Cultural Revolution, which was a revolution against traditional culture, mm-hmm. delivered a fatal blow to Confucius? Or is there some part of that tradition which is survived or has been reborn?
I think there are a lot of good values. I think they may not belong to Confucianism originally, but Confucianism. I'm not a Confucianist at all, but I do feel that as an ethical system, really, it dominated China and the Chinese culture for a long time, and whether it's a positive or a negative, that I think it is still maybe we can talk about that, but it's still uncertain, I think. Because Confucianism doesn't have a strong sense of hierarchy. Also, the order, create order within the state of China. And basically, it's to serve the governance of the state. So I'm not positive about that. But on the other hand, there are a lot of basic good values really have been kept by that system. So they are valuable. They are very valuable. But I think China now at the stage, I think every one of us, just the fact that we are here, we are beyond that. We already wandered outside the vision of Confucius, right? This space have never been imagined by our ancestors. So we have to live and imagine different kinds of things. We had to borrow, accept, and take from other cultures, other countries, to create something new, more suitable to China and Chinese. I think that it should be the right way of doing things. Again, I'm not a politician, I'm not a statesman, but just as an individual, I feel that contemporary Chinese, we live in a different world. We have to really learn from other countries, other cultures.
Does it bother you that this book will not make it into mainland China?
It will be published in Taiwan, but not in mainland China, I think. But you know, more than half of my books cannot be published in mainland China. So I'm used to it, in other words. I'm really used to it. In fact, a book of this nature, I think it's better not to be published now, because then it will be cut here and there, and then you feel that the book really would lose the bite, or the teeth would be pulled, and it doesn't have the sharpness and the edge anymore.
So your past few books, they've all taken place outside of China. Mm. Can you imagine writing another book that's set in China again, or do you think you're...
It's possible. But I don't think I would, not current China. Maybe, you know, China has a long history. Any period, yes, it is entirely possible.
Are you writing for Chinese in some way? I mean, is it, are you always listening to what that reaction would be, or are you basically writing for the outside world?
I think Chinese is the part, I don't have a specific group as audience, but I do have a kind of ideal audience. That's why I mentioned the word, the principle of translatability. So the Chinese would be a part of the reader, the reader in the abstract sense, in the ideal sense, the ideal reader, that would include Chinese. For instance, the paragraph you read would make more sense, more surprising, shocking to Chinese.
Yeah. But I had a strong sense in reading this, and in a way it was almost as if it were a love letter to China. A very disappointed, sometimes angry, sometimes, you know, frustrated letter.
Maybe. I think that the young man, he couldn't separate himself from China. Two curves.
But he's your creation.
Yes, yes. So I created him. You know, he has two curses. One is his ex-wife, and then another is China, mother China, right? Yeah. And then the ex-wife.
But it's almost as if China is acquainted with the unbearable ex-wife.
Related, yes. In a way, emotionally, sure. Yeah, because he was hurt by both.
Yeah.
Just on this identity issue again, do you identify as a Chinese writer, or do you consider yourself, I mean, or is that, I know that's kind of an annoying question, but I feel like in America, right now, especially in literature, it's become such a hot topic, right? Like the identity of writers, you can't really separate it, right? So I'm just curious, if do you see yourself as having one identity or another as a writer?
No, I'm a Chinese-American writer. So for me, I mean, even the hyphen is necessary because I live in China almost for 30 years. No, that part, that's part of my past that shaped my sensibility and personality. It would be suicidal if I just get rid of that and just claim I'm a pure American writer. No, that would not make sense. Mm-hmm. But on the other hand, I've lived in the States longer than in China. I've never been back to China since I came. So in that sense, you know, I've been becoming an American writer.
So I'm sure all of you have lots of questions, and I see we're heading towards half past the hour. So raise your hands, and because you will be webcasting, they want our readers, our listeners, to be able to hear. So let's start right up front, and we'll work our way back.
You mentioned briefly.
Jerry, identify yourself. Ask all of you to please identify yourselves.
Jerry Cohen, NYU Law School. You mentioned briefly Eastern European writers. Mm-hmm. I assume you included Soviet. How would you compare the product of Soviet writers with the product of communist Chinese writers? Are the themes very different, for example, because of Solzhenitsyn after he came out, preoccupation with Stalinism, the Gulag, the quality different? How would you compare the two products of two major communist systems in contemporary literature, whether within the country or in exile?
I think that's a great question. I'm glad to meet you finally, Mr. Cohen. And sure. And I think the two literatures, they are not the same. And the Chinese is much inferior to the Russian Soviet literature in that sense, because partly I think because, and the Russians they have a grand tradition right before them. They have the golden period. They have Gogol, Chekhov, Turgenev, Dostoevsky, Tolstoy. So these people, the people after them, basically their sons and children and grandchildren. So that heritage is there. There was a still kind of reverence, even among the authorities, for literature, for great writers like Pasternak and some poets too. But on the Chinese side, there had been very weak tradition before that. We have some modernist writers like Lu Xun, Ba Jin, but they were not giants compared with the great Russians. Also, the Chinese system, censorship, the system is more subtle. I think the Chinese, in imitation of the Russians, the Soviets, they set up the system of literary writers association. They try to control the creative energy, creative talents, and make best use of them to serve the party and the politics. And also a lot of them became officials. Still, many of the top talents, they are officials. For instance, every chairman of provinces or major cities, writers association, basically is a major official in that province or city. It is still the case. So in other words, China has its own system that is more subtle. More confining, more inward than the Soviet system. That's why I think, in brief, there is no comparison there. There's no Akhmatova, Pasternak, not to mention Solzhenitsyn. These are giants. They were China. The Chinese scene doesn't have these great writers.
Okay, there's a question right here in the aisle. Yep.
Mr. Jin, you have studied American and English literature for many years, mm-hmm. and you've been teaching it in American campuses. Mm-hmm. So do you feel that as sort of just an academic who studied the field for a long time, and at the same time being also a writer in English of Chinese background, of Chinese civilization, do you think that you bring certain unique insights into your teaching? And has that been part of your teaching process? And do you think the students have benefited from that?
I do. And I teach literature and creative writing. And the best part of the teaching experience, we talk about this with teaching as a career. And I think the best part is to see my students get the books published. And because I have been a creative writer, so very often I approach literature from a writer's point of view. I would take a book apart and see how that was made, how each part is related to others. So my approach is both rather practical. So also I spend a lot of time with the creative graduate students who write fiction and basically help them go through the process of writing their first book. I think that as a result, I think over the years, some of them really they began to publish. So and I wouldn't say because I'm a Chinese, so my approach and all my teaching are more valuable because of that. I think perhaps related to my military background, I served in the Chinese army for 5.5 years, so my approach is rather straightforward, practical, and see what is, how this is done. So that helped me a lot. I think also discipline, that's important. Try to teach the beginning writers to take this as a calling and create a discipline, self-discipline, in order to continue.
I won't exercise my prerogative to ask him how his military influence experience influences writing, but maybe one of you will. So, more hands. So, a woman right here.
Hi, I'm Pia Patacone. I'm also a writer.
Thank you.
My question is how, you know, you mentioned you haven't been to China since you came here. How do you maintain such a strong connection to the country and everything that's going on there? And sort of a part two, do you ever see yourself not writing about China?
Okay, let me answer the second part first. I think I will write about China. Not China itself, but some Chinese related to China. I think there's nothing to. I think for me, it's a source of strength and energy. It's my past. It would be suicidal and shameful if I tried or attempt to suppress to get rid of that. So there's no doubt about that. And I think the task will be how make it related to others, how to make it universal. So that is the part. That's why when we talk about a story set in ancient China, it's not that difficult to find a story. There are stories everywhere, but in what way it is meaningful and can be significant. That is the challenge. That is the difficult part. But because I lived in China, I grew up in China, and I really feel that there's something within that is already shaped when I came. So that can very hard to change. It's impossible. And so as a result, I think I always feel that that part is a part of myself. I can't just destroy it and like dump it like extra baggage. You can't do that. So for me, as a migrant, as an immigrant, the challenge will be how to make the best use of that. So there was a long struggle because you can't take everything on a trip. You'll be crushed. So for me, that's why I always try to find new things I can make, do something meaningful in English, but somehow related to my past. I read news every day on different sites, overseas, especially overseas Chinese news sites, like Wan Xiang, Wan Wei, many others. And also I have friends, some Chinese friends, so I do have communications with them. But, you know, my family, except my immediate family, everybody else is in China. So we do have close contact. In short, there's no way for me to separate myself from China. I think it would be silly for me to do that. So as a result, I always try to figure out how to make this useful, meaningful. For instance, I've been working on a biography of Li Bai, you know, the Chinese great ancient Chinese poet, because I discovered there was no biography of his in English. So that's something I should do, also meaningful. They're also part of Chinese culture, a major part. So I think there's nothing to be ashamed of. I think there's a pride in that. I do believe that. I feel that way.
Okay, the woman right here.
With head or without head? Okay.
Hi, my name is Linda, a Chinese New Yorker. I actually share a very similar experience with you. I came from China many years ago. I was educated here, got my PhD, and ended up raising my family here. So I find your thoughts, your relationship with China is fascinating, using an ex-wife. To me, China, if I were a man, is more like mistress. And I wonder if that feeling difference in... Are they different? Yeah, they're very different in feelings, right? I wonder if that has to do with the fact that you haven't gone back for over three decades. And I've been going back every single year, if not every year, every other year. So every time I go back, I get excited because there's something new, there's something interesting. So I wondered how whether that's the reason and why you haven't been back for 31 years. I don't know if there are any particular reason.
First, the ex-wife is not my it's not my relationship with China. It's the characters, because my wife and I, we've been married many years, 35 years. So we were married in China. So there was this is really purely fictional, but the really. But your comments really make good sense. If I could go back to China regularly, sure, my perception would be different, my feeling would be different, my understanding may be also different too. But because I cannot go back to China, I somehow landed on kind of a blacklist. That's why I couldn't. In fact, my mother died 3 years ago. Before that, she had been in the hospital for 4 years. I applied for a visa for many times in order to go back to see her, but I couldn't. I just didn't see her when she died. So that kind of frustration and really that I would say corrosion, right, make you feel sick inside. That's why a lot some Chinese, they're in exile. I asked them a question. I said, how do you feel about China? Very often you hear the word disgusting. The reason for that, not because these people, they are mean, because the person who used that word, he was in prison, he was beaten up many times. So imagine if you were in that situation, how would you feel? So that's why I try not to apply for visas anymore. Because every time for a few weeks, I would feel very, very upset, disappointed, and also hurt. And so I just don't want to repeat that. And there is a sense that the people, that the power that be basically is there to create pain and frustration for others. That's their job, their duty. So I try to avoid that. So I understand if if I have the privilege of going back to China and visiting my friends, the relatives regularly, sure, my perception, the feeling would be different. But a lot of things were already created over decades, created by the powers, and not just myself, and a lot of China scholars too. And they invested their time, their energy, lives in this field. But if you made one mistake, basically you are banned, right? And for instance, my friend Perry Ling, he has not been allowed to go to China for more than 3 decades. 27 years. But people like that, I think of course the feeling would be very different. So that's why we have to take the individual's experience into account. Whenever I think of China, I always feel that that's a metal wall. No matter what, you can run into it, no matter how hard, it will not respond. So you should avoid.
Okay, the woman right here in the hat.
Hello, my name is Xiaoyan Lin. I'm actually a young Chinese poet. And I know you were a part of the Misty Poetry Movement. And most of the poets from that movement got exiled, including Bei Dao and others. And then I'm a big fan of Misty Poetry. And I'm just wondering, I know right now you're mostly writing novels in English. Do you still write poetry in Chinese? And what do you think about today's Chinese modern poetry? Because the Misty Poetry, back that time, it was like the Chinese golden age.
I've been writing poetry, and I started my writing career by writing poetry. But I don't think I was a member of the Misty group, really, they were more privileged than compared, you know, than me, because, you know, I'm from the provinces. I mean, I went to college in Heilongjiang, and I served in the army in Jilin, and it's really, we are marginal people. So we are far. We were far away from the cultural centers. The mystic group, mainly they were people from Beijing and Guangzhou, Xiamen, those culturally active cities. But I didn't have the privilege. So in other words, my writing of poetry came rather late. I began to write poetry in English first. Seriously, I mean. My first book was a book of poems. And then later, my job was, my first job was to teach poetry. I was a poet in residence at Emory University. So that's how I began to write poetry. I had to write poetry very seriously. But in recent years, I've been writing poetry in Chinese. In fact, 2 years ago, I published a book of poems in Taiwan. It's called Another Space, 另一个空间. And next January, another book of poems will be brought out in Taipei too. It's called 路上的家园, Home on the Road. And I've been doing this for years. But then I also rewrite some of the poems in English. So in other words, I'm trying to writing poetry in both languages. This is a new way of writing. For me, this is a serious. As for mystic poetry, I do have a different understanding. Because I've been working on Asian Chinese poetry, so I had different understanding. And my approach is different, too. I don't think anything is mystical in my poetry at all. I love the phrase, the principle made by Li Bai. You know, he has two statements. One is, let me try to, 清水出芙蓉, 天然巨雕饰, you know, lotus flowers come out from limpid water, natural without decoration. And that's his ideal state of poetry. Everything should be natural, limpid. He has another statement, 明月直入,无心可猜. Moonlight comes straight from outside without the need for guessing. So I think in Tang Dynasty, even throughout the Chinese poetry, the poetic tradition, there is an emphasis on the immediacy, the sensation of thought. So I really want to try to pursue that kind of a tradition. We can have ideas and the feelings, but I don't want to make them obscure. I want to make them really transparent and sometimes deep too. This is our old tradition. I've been writing poetry seriously, but I still feel like a beginner. But I have different understanding, different conception of poetry now. Ideally, I would think, you know, Auden, W.H. Auden, he said something provide in the old grand manner with a resonant heart. I think that is the ideal state. Old-fashioned doesn't matter, as long as you have a resonant heart.
Right here. And then we'll move to the back for two questions, and then I think we have to wrap it up.
I'm Nick Platt. I used to be in charge of this place. And like Orville and like Jerry and so forth, member of the generation that in the 60s decided that it would be a good idea to learn Chinese, or to study it anyway. No one ever learns it. I started reading your books because you were a Chinese writer, and I wanted to learn about China. And I did. But what really impressed me the most was your style in writing English. And that's why, I mean, I've been a big fan for many years. Your style is so spare. There's so little bullshit in it. Well, maybe none. But I'm really interested in how you developed that as a writer in English. I know from my own experience struggling with Chinese and trying to express myself in Chinese that when you did that spoken language, you spared things down because you didn't know how to say it any other way. Mm-hmm. You couldn't do anything complex or fancy. But I'm very interested in the way you developed your style. I have one more comment that I'd like to make, and that is that your poetry is really quite universal.
Thank you.
And I fashioned an entire graduation speech around a poem that you wrote.
Oh, really?
About making your shoes to fit your feet.
Yeah, the past.
I found that worked very well. Mm-hmm. But anyway, my question to you really is, when you were starting to write in English and so on and so forth, what mechanical processes were you going through? Was it just a soldier from Heilongjiang trying to be simple, or what?
Soldiers' experience really had something to do with this, because that made me more able to take the labor, the drudgery. In fact, especially fiction, it so much depends on the work you put into a book. Draft after draft, and of course there are other great models. For instance, we all know, I think some of you must know, there's a great anecdote, Flaubert, a great stylist, and he the anecdote of the Simon Colin, his friends went to another country, Italy, over the weekend. They wanted him to go, he didn't go, and they all went. He stayed home working on his manuscript, and they returned and told him what a wonderful time they had, and he said, I also had a wonderful time. On Sunday, I put in a semicolon. On Saturday, I took it out.
So, I think that's a somewhat distorted sense of a good time.
So, of course, you at some point, I think you enjoy the pen, right? The labor. Mm. But there is, I think that is important for a writer, especially a literary writer, to really to aim for perfection. That's an illusion. But we have to be honest. I really usually, especially a piece of fiction or poem, I had to reach the point I feel that I can't do anything. At the moment, no matter what, I can't change a word. But of course, 2 weeks later, I have a different story. I might find another something. So I think that really is an endless process. I do feel that, I think somehow, because I write poetry, so the prose, I do feel that every word must take its position to contribute to the sentence. I have the sense of economy and also I think rhythm. I think for me it's very important, the aura of the language. That's why a lot of people who they read Waiting, some of them would say thank you. They would say it's so simple, and there's nothing complicated. But there's another thing that is beyond language. That is, there's a feeling. You have to create the feeling that is among the words, beneath the word. That's the hard part too, I think. So in other words, in essence, it all depends on how much work I can put into it. A piece of work. Thank you for your words on the poem of the past. That really means a lot to me. Means a lot to me. If the image is important, that we talk about the past, but how to make use of it. That's why the shoes image.
to make better shoes so you can travel with it.
Okay, a young woman right on the aisle, black.
Hello, my name is Ximong Chen. I'm a freelance translator and interpreter. So naturally, my question is about the translation of your work from English into Chinese. Mm-hmm. So as a bilingual writer and also a native Chinese speaker, I know that most of your works are translated into Chinese through like third-party translators instead of by yourself. But when you read these translations, despite of, you know, the fact that like a lot of them are censored and, you know, big parts are taken out, does it feel closer to your own voice in some ways, since it's your mother tongue? And since I think in one of the interviews that you did with the Chinese media, you mentioned that if you were writing in Chinese, you might have been a more accomplished writer in some ways because it's, you know, your native language. And I think you mentioned that you struggled a lot, you know, just in learning English and writing in English. So my question is the translation somehow closer to what you wanted to say? And you mentioned that, you know, some sentences even sound stronger in Chinese rather than in English. So thank you.
Really, it varies from translator to translator. Because once a contract is signed for translation, there is always a deadline attached to it. So when I work all the time, so I couldn't finish a big project. So that's why I only translated some of my short stories. I would say every translator, given the limit of time, they really did their best. And I wouldn't say all the voices are close to my original. It's very hard, especially a book like Waiting. So much depends on the rhythm and the aura of the prose. It's very hard to reproduce that in Chinese. Chinese is very fluent, very close to natural speech, northern dialect, Dongbeihua, right? Very close to that. But it's a different kind of a charm. But in English, it's another kind. It's more subtle in that sense. There is a loss there. Of course, the fact that I do believe that if I wrote in Chinese, I would have accomplished more. I do believe that. Because that would be a different approach. I would try to learn a lot about foreign literature, even other languages, so that I can bring stuff into Chinese. That is a really different kind of a job, different kind of duty, different kind of a goal, especially given the fact that Chinese, the language has been damaged and violated for decades. So there were different kind of, there could be different kind of achievement. But on the other hand, this is a pure speculation. You know, our life, so many things are accidental. Really, we don't know what might happen.
Emily, do you want to ask the last question? Whatever.
Oh, that you should have put me on the spot there. I don't know. Do you have anything that I'll think for a second?
I mean, I think...
Well, okay, all right. Actually do have a question, since it's sort of, since it actually is kind of this whole book about, you know, being a boat rocker, and I guess you're sort of a boat rocker, right? Would you consider yourself
But he's so mild-mannered.
I don't think I intended it. You know, this book he intended it to do because he was a journalist.
Well, I think what's interesting about this, though, is I think you touch on this really pivotal question about, you know, writing inside of China or writing outside of China,
yeah,
right?
Sure,
like, here's
yes.
this, the main character in this book is somebody who just really wants to stay true to themselves,
yes,
right? And isn't willing to compromise at all. And then he's kind of coming up across all these people who are saying, well, it's pointless, you know?
Yes.
There's sort of there's a feeling of futility
sure.
a little bit, right?
Yes,
it's like,
sure,
I'm going to stand my ground, and I'm going to stand on principle, but at the end of the day, you know, China's so much bigger than
He doesn't end very well.
No. But on the hand, there is a ray of hope because, you know, he is going to be a scholar. There is a possibility whether he will be a graduate student, a PhD student, we don't know. But the door is somehow semi-open to him. So I think that's important. I think there in this, in United States, in the culture and society, there is the space, possibility. You work. In other words, his ambition is to become a public intellectual. So he might become one if he works hard and doesn't make many mistakes.
Well, here's the question, though. Can somebody like this, somebody who's a boat rocker, who's unwilling to compromise, unwilling to say things a different way, can they have an impact on China? Can they? Or
eventually, yes. That's why it's important for him to really make effort to become a public intellectual, not just in name. So think of a great intellectuals like Said, and of course, you know, he has huge impact he had on different cultures. But of course, this guy, they didn't have that kind of privilege in the education, but there's a possibility for him to choose a different life. I think in a way, this reflects the condition of exile, the Chinese exile Chinese writers. And I think in the early 90s, many exile writers and intellectuals, they had the opportunity to go to graduate school, but they didn't. They assumed China would open the door and the Tiananmen massacre would be corrected. And so they will return to their homeland. They also think, some of them also, they were vain and thought it would be easier to live a writer's life instead of doing the graduate work, hard work. So as a result, China does not change. China didn't give a damn to these people. So the lesson was clear. You can't wait for a country to change. You have to change yourself. So that's why at the end, he decided, he listened to his friend's advice, a very patriotic friend's advice. He would be trying to get into graduate school.
He's playing the long game, in a way.
Long game. So yeah. That's the only way. I think that's a good way for him to survive.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, listen, you can buy The Boat Rocker outside, and Ha Jin will be there to sign it, and he has many other books out there. And join me in thanking him for a wonderful writer, wonderful book.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.